Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us today for the third of the Art for the Environment conversations. My name is Camilla Palestra, and I'm a curator. I work at the Center for Sustainable Fashion, where I've been working together with Professor Lucy Orta on the Art for the Environment International Artist Residency Programme. The programme was launched in 2015 as a way to offer UAL students and alumni the incredible opportunity to take part in a fully funded residency across the globe in amazing environments, thanks to the collaboration with our partners from Brazil to Canada, from India, across Europe and the UK. In a moment in which the physical residencies are on pause because of the restrictions for COVID-19, I thought it would be a good moment, a good opportunity to come together to invite some of our partners and our residents to understand more about their experiences and how their creative role can impact a vision of a world of tomorrow. So I'm very pleased today to have with us Mathias Schwartz-Clauss, director at Domaine de Boisbuchet, Design, Architecture, Nature in France. Lisa Pettibone, artist and former resident at Boisbuchet, and Laetitia Forst, the textile designer, candidate for the next residency hopefully in the summer. Mathias Schwartz-Clauss is an art historian and curator. He studied art history and philosophy at the Universität Trier and Ruhr Universität Bochum in Germany. From 1992 until 2013, he was curator at the Vitra Design Museum in Weil am Rhein in Germany, and in charge of numerous internationally traveling exhibitions and catalogues, such as the World of Charles and Ray Eames, the first Ron Arad retrospective, Frank Lloyd Wright, The Living City, Living in Motion. Since 2013, he's responsible for workshops, exhibitions, and the architectural park at Domaine de Boisbuchet in France. His special interests are aimed at the human condition and the intersection of design and art. Lisa Pettibone's art practice questions how the world is put together in terms of energy, forces and form as filtered through human perception. Exploring through materials, she creates installation and sculpture using glass, fabric, paper, plastic, and uses photography and printmaking to investigate areas where man and nature intersect. Projects often incorporate research into scientific concepts, collaboration, or site-specific work. She was artist in residence at Modular Space Science Lab at UCL in 2019 and has an MA in Art and Science from Central St. Martins at UAL. And finally, Laetitia Forst is a multi-technique textile designer whose practice explores the tension between technical challenges and creativity in sustainable design for textiles. Laetitia trained as a textile designer at the École Nationale Supérieure des Arts Décoratifs in Paris, before working as a freelance textile designer for fashion, interiors, and consulting in eco-design. She carried out her PhD research about textile design for disassembly in the context of design for recycling at the Center for Circular Design at Chelsea College of Art.
Thank you very much, Camilla. Boisbuchet's workshops started actually in 1919 in a tent in front of the Vitra Design Museum. At the time, the museum's founding director, Alexander van Vegesack, aimed to create a platform for design experimentation addressed primarily to design students. And later on, a couple of 2 years later on, he moved the operation to Boisbuchet, a 150-acre domain which he had acquired especially for that place. So this is the center of the domain, with a chateau in the middle, but you can see that, in a hilly landscape in the southwest of France. And since 1992, the workshops are not only addressed to students, but also to professionals from all over the world, always taking place in the summer. Between June and September, we are running, today it's about 30 workshops per year, very, very interdisciplinarily, from hair design to jewelry and body adornment to something like landscape design, architecture, interior design, furniture, lighting, scenography. And a lot of these workshops take, of course, a lot of advantage of the site, which is a beautiful, pretty untouched nature. And I'm just showing you a couple of images that represent the scope of what we are doing here. It's not that only the nature is an inspiration for form finding. It's also giving a lot of opportunities in realizing projects such as architectural performance project on the lake of Boisbuchet. Mm. We've got a very well equipped workshop, plaster, for metalworking, for glass, for ceramics, for textile, for audio and visual arts, which again allows to work inside, outside, on different sites. We're doing food design workshops. Often we invite, our tutors are coming as our participants from all over the world, but we often invite also universities to cooperate with us, and museums and companies. Here you see a glass workshop with the Corning Museum of Glass from upstate New York, which regularly comes with this container, allowing participants to work with hot glass, but then we also do cold glass workshops. This is a performance with a Danish designer, Henrik Vibskov, fashion designer. And there, again, you can see what scope and what scale of disciplines and disciplinary workshops are possible. Here there is a workshop where we are doing a creative session combined with yoga in one of our pavilions. And actually these pavilions are an important part of the site. We've got about 20 different architectural structures, which most realized in the frame of these workshops. This here is a pavilion in our vegetable garden with Shigeru Ban. Some architectural workshops involve, like others as well, high-tech solutions, very innovative high-tech solutions. Here they are spraying clay with a drone on a cupola, but also sometimes very basic iconic pieces come into being, such as this little log hut, or again a very complex high-tech result of a workshop of a corporation, not a workshop, this was not a workshop, but a corporation with the Rhode Island School of Design and the Brown University, both from Providence, Rhode Island in the United States, and several companies such as Microsoft and Saint-Gobain, a French construction company, who realized this house in cooperation with Boisbuchet as a residence for future tutors and VIP guests, which we are using that building right now. The castle is pretty much empty normally, but we are using both main floors for exhibitions. We can show the results of the workshops, but mostly are addressed to the participants of the workshops and the tutors, of course, and international guests who come to visit this architectural park and these exhibitions, which are very focused on special subjects, but always addressed and explained in a way that it's understandable for a very, very large audience with different layers of reading, and always concerning subjects that also are dear to Boisbuchet's workshops and activities, which is the environment, which is the social care, which is about international and intergenerational communication. These had been always the key subjects of Boisbuchet's workshops. And for the coming year, we've got for this year, we are pretty much repeating the same what we had envisioned for last year. Impossible to do that last year, but big names, which always is always nice to have, but also big themes such as interior architecture, lighting, some very material oriented workshops with hemp and clay and wax, but also some interdisciplinary workshops such as philosophical, architectural and sociological and design related reflection on our human relationship with nature in this post-natural era, according to Bruno Latour, the French philosopher, or with bamboo. Or we are doing a workshop on we're building a planetarium, no, an observatorium on one of the fields of Boisbuchet, the Spanish group of architects. So really a large range of projects. We're going to do an exhibition also this year, which will focus on the collection we are having here. It is a comprehensive design collection of about 2,500 objects, not only including design, but also arts, architecture, and crafts. This will be a general overview celebrating the collection and celebrating the 30th anniversary of our workshops. And parallel to that, another exhibition, which will be more an online exhibition, but inviting visitors of Boisbuchet's Domaine to walk around and discover all kinds of subjects related to the forest by following an application on their app, and from going from a forest cemetery to some general explanation about energy, coal mining, etc., etc. Then there is a festival going to be here in this September, which is again together with this interdisciplinary group about Bruno Latour's theories about our human relationship with nature. And that's pretty much the program for this year. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mathias. You condensed so much in such a short presentation. I'm sure there will be questions at the end to expand on some aspects of your program and activities. But I will hand it over now to Lisa.
Hello, everybody. I'm Lisa Pettibone. I'm an artist, a visual artist, and I'll give you a little introduction to my practice and then talk about my residency at Boisbuchet, and then another residency which seems really relevant to this discussion at Mollard Space Science Laboratory. Let's see if it's going through. Okay, so my background originally is in graphic design. I'm originally from California, but I came to the UK in the 90s, and I worked as an art director for the BBC for a period of time, and then went and did a 3D design and glass degree at UCA in Farnham in Surrey in the UK, and then went on to do an MA in art and science at Central St. Martin's in 2018. I live and work in Surrey near Guildford in the UK. I'm part of a collective called Lumen Studios, which has been going since 2015, and they concentrate on themes of astronomy and light, and another artist group called ArtCan. The residency at the Space Science Laboratory happened or finished in 2019, but I'm also a member of the Moon Village Association and part of their cultural considerations working group, concerned with the cultural impact of a settlement on the moon, and I've been helping them run some events for that concern. So what do I say about my work? My work considers how the world is put together in terms of energy, forces, and form as filtered through human perception. Exploring through materials, I create sculpture, glass, fabric, and paper, installations, and use photography and printmaking to investigate areas where man and nature intersect. Often, this process incorporates periods of research into scientific concepts, collaboration or site-specific projects, and recent work responds to an interest in gravity, astronomy, and physics. I actually did my dissertation at Central St. Martin's in responding to the idea of gravity and the aesthetic qualities of gravity. So my practice is in several parts. I develop work for exhibition and also do commissions, but I regularly try to take part in residencies. I teach specialized glassmaking courses from my studio and at other venues as well. And importantly, I'm an advocate for interdisciplinary practice. I organize art and science activities such as seminars and exhibitions. This is always in collaboration with other people. And I've also hosted creative workshops at science institutions, including CERN in Geneva, the European Space Agency in the Netherlands, and at University College in London. So this is just a few samples of some of my work over the last couple of years, a glass installation on the left and a screen print, which use data from the European Space Agency in the background there. Both of these projects refer to my interest in dark matter. And a few more recent pieces, forming glass into quite open forms, questioning volume and tension, and really exploiting the properties of the material completely. So Boisbuchet was an absolutely fantastic experience for me. It was wonderful to go from my degree straight into this workshop, which was called Solar Futures, and it was run by artist Janet Eshelman. She does massive both outdoor and indoor kind of webbed installations, which actually react to light and movement of the air, and they're suspended usually at quite a high level. So it was exciting to meet her, talk to her, and be involved with this project through her. The project goal was to design and construct a site-specific self-illuminating installation using thin film solar voltaic technology, quite a mouthful that, and this was provided by a German company called Obvious, who kindly came and showed us how the technology worked, gave us soldering lessons on how to put together the technology, and then left us to try and figure out how to make an installation using all these components in this fabulous location. There was about 15 of us. It's hard to remember exactly now. But the idea that we came up with in the end was to look at how the sun transforms light in the in plant life, the chlorophyll process. And we decided to use the array of solar cells in the configuration of a chloroform molecule. And that would catch light during the day and actually light up these little bunches of lights 35 feet up into the top of the tree. It was hard to decide where to put this because there's so many fabulous locations there. And then as part of the experience, and Janet was quite keen that the installation was not just technologically interesting, but also was an interesting experience for people, drawing them out into this area of nature in on the property, that we made a platform out of a specialized kind of rope, knot time. We were very lucky and had an artist who was an expert at macrame, helped us weave this fabulous platform. I did a little work on a copper structure that was supposed to hold the lights. There's a picture of me up in the top right, stripping loads of wire with a bunch of other people. And in the end, we ended up not really using it. But I think I came away from this residency feeling as though when you get such a diverse group of people together, you know, there were architects, designers, students studying design and architecture, and artists sort of all working together. We all combined fabulous skills, and unfortunately, I don't have a final shot of the piece itself, but it really was a quite a magical thing to go out there at nighttime, lay on this platform, look at this sort of kind of cloud of what almost look like stars or galaxy, and contemplate how we use the resources of our planet and do it sustainably. So it was perfect for me to go on from this project to thinking about how I might apply that. I had a kind of sculpture that I wanted to apply the technology to, and these are dichroic forms about 75 centimeters high that actually move in the ambient air, and I was hoping to apply the technology to it, but found that it was actually incredibly expensive to print the circuits that you need to draw down the energy, and I tried getting funding a couple of times, but perhaps it's a project for the future. So I went on to do this residency the following September at Mullard Space Science Laboratory, and there I was interested. I had begun an interest in dark matter and how it distorts light in space. And one of the astrophysicists there invited me to follow the Euclid mission, which is a European Space Agency initiative to study dark matter in the universe, dark matter and dark energy. And it's not launching till 2022. But the project was a wonderful way to combine art and science, both for the people at the lab and for myself, to see how we could find places of common ground. So I interviewed the scientists and I ran creative workshops right in the middle of their common room in their lab. I went into the labs themselves. They explained to me how the instrument they were making for this giant space telescope was put together. And then I did a final exhibition in London, and perhaps one of the most long-lasting effects of the residency is I created with a group of about 250 scientists a collaborative artwork. It's found there in the middle, which is called the Fingertip Galaxy, and we created an artwork with painted fingertips from many scientists working on the project. And this graphic will be reduced down and is actually going to go on the spacecraft itself. So I think what I took away from this project, I mean, this is, I'll show you just one final shot of the exhibition that I did. This is one of the installations called Cosmic Landscape. That it's a really important trend, I think, in society to start working cross-disciplinary or in a cross-disciplinary sort of way. Artists and scientists together actually have more in common than you would think. They both rely on creative insight to a great degree, but they give each other different points of view as to where they're coming from in terms of what their curiosity is and how they think they can apply those ideas. And the cross-pollination, I think, is quite important. So I'm just going to, I think now I'm going to run a little 2-minute film, which is a nice way to run, kind of wind up this talk, which is a short really from the Arts Council funded film that I did on the back of this residency. Anyway, thank you very much. I think Abby's going to run the film now. Thank you.
Hi everyone, so I'm Laetitia Forst, and thank you Camilla for the introduction at the beginning. And it's also just been really, really great to hear the presentations from Mathias and from Lisa. And I think I have to start with the fact that I'm extremely excited to have been selected for this residency, and also restate the fact that I haven't done it yet, and that unfortunately it was delayed. I was due to sort of go to Domaine de Boisbuchet last summer, and I mean, as it has been mentioned, that program was cancelled. So seeing these teasers for it has really made me very excited about what's coming ahead, hopefully this summer. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about my work and how I see it relating to what I think I'll be doing in the Domaine de Boisbuchet residency. So I applied to take part in the workshop led by Fernando Laposte called Fiber Power, which is going to be looking at two fibers, hemp and sisal. And I don't know if you know about Fernando's work, but so inspiring. He's definitely up there in my list of favorite designers. And his work is really, really insightful in the way that it sort of really hones in on all the characteristics of the material. So it's not only their sort of physical properties, but it's also the sort of social and cultural histories that come behind it. And I really hope that that's something that I can learn a lot from in the residency. And hopefully you'll understand a little bit how this relates to my work and the practice that I have been developing as part of my PhD project. So when I applied for the residency, I was actually in the process of finishing my thesis, which is called Textile Design for Disassembly. And that's the very long wordy subtitle underneath it. And essentially, so that's finished now, and I'm really looking forward to sort of taking those ideas into the next step, and I'll talk a little bit about how I think I'm going to be able to do that. But essentially, the big idea behind my thesis was trying to understand how we can solve issues of textile waste through designing for disassembly. So one of the big premises for this work is the fact that waste is really just resources in the wrong place. And to be able to sort of recycle effectively and achieve some of the aims of a circular economy, we need to consider our resources according to their recycling cycles or sort of their biodegradability capacity. So this is a diagram by the Ellen MacArthur Foundation, which is used quite a lot. I'm sure some of you might be familiar with it, maybe a bit too familiar with it sometimes. And the idea here is that most textile resources are recyclable in one way or another. And the Ellen MacArthur Foundation and Cradle to Cradle separate them into two cycles. On one hand, you have, in blue here, the technical cycle in which materials can be recycled in industrial processes. And on the other hand, we have the biosphere in which materials can be composted and returned to nature. The main issue is that as soon as we start combining materials from those two different cycles, then they become extremely difficult to actually recycle effectively, and that's where you end up with waste in landfill. And in the textile world, everything that we have is made of a blend. Most textiles are made of a blend of polyester and cotton, of sort of viscose nylon, etc., etc., etc. So what my work was trying to do was trying to address this issue and try and understand how we can start deconstructing blends and thinking about how we use materials more responsibly. So blends are actually quite a sort of a technical response to some of the issues that we have in industry. It's a lot about reducing the cost of the material, trying to make it work better in terms of the performance of the actual material, but also make it just run through machines a lot easier. But what I was really interested in is the fact that as textile designers, blending or combining materials that have different colors, different textures, is just an inherent part of what makes the creative joy of making textiles. So I was kind of faced with a dilemma there, in the way that I knew that one of the things that I consider essential to my textile design practice is actually creating a barrier to recycling. So my challenge was to try and understand how we could still maintain that creativity and the joy that comes from combining different resources, but still allowing for the resources to be recovered and recycled effectively at end of life. So I started diving into design for disassembly and understanding what that might mean for textiles. So design for disassembly is actually fairly established in field of industrial product design and electronics product design. You probably know that like our phones and computers, etc., have like a lot of very valuable or very toxic materials inside of them. So there's been incentives around legislation to actually encourage design to take into account how those resources are going to be taken out of the product at end of life. So that's sort of an example in the HP Z1 workstation, in which the computer can be flipped open and the different components can be replaced or repaired or recycled. And the example on the left here is a Think Chair by Steelcase, and it's actually sort of held up as the big example for design for disassembly at a product level. And one of the things that's really brilliant with this chair design is that it really takes into account the fact that in some cases we're going to need different materials. You need the foam padding, you need the structural metal components, but in this case it's designed so that each of those functional components can be taken apart, and when it's taken apart it's made of a single monomaterial recyclable resource. And it can be taken apart in under 5 minutes in a disassembly production line using no specialist tools. So these are just two examples out of a big practice review that I did at the beginning of my work to try and understand all the characteristics of design for disassembly and trickle those through into my textile practice. So I'll skip through all of the theory that went around that, but really just to focus on how that became textiles. So the outcome for my practice then took the form of a series of textile samples that demonstrated different ways in which different material components could be assembled so that they could be taken apart at the end of life, so that in theory they could be returned to the appropriate recycling system. So these samples all used placeholder materials, so they weren't actually made of different recyclable resources specifically, but they were made to be a form of blank canvas. So you could imagine here that the different layers could be replaced with any type of material that you know the recycling outcome for. So to do this, I actually used a range of different textile techniques, every time using my background knowledge as a textile designer and my knowledge of these different textile construction and assembly techniques, whether it was laser cutting and then hand assembly in the way that you would sort of do embellishment and like quite large scale textile construction, using weaving or felting. And through this work, I developed like a repertoire of techniques to assemble these different resources so that they could be taken apart. Here you see stills videos of the work of all these different samples, looking at different ways in which the assembly and the disassembly could happen. And one of the things I was particularly interested in seeing the results from this experimentation really goes back to my initial point of trying to take this as a creative exploration. And I really like to think of sustainability challenges as, rather than a constraint, something that we have to work within the small circle of, as a way to trigger the imagination and really sort of like launch a design challenge. And I think that's one of the things that we get really excited about as designers, is this initial problem and trying to find ways around it, trying to find ways of surmounting it. And by developing these different textile design for disassembly techniques, I found that I was also developing new aesthetics for textiles, that even though I was trying to mimic specific textiles, sort of problematic textiles that I'd identified, such as like coated textiles, which are really hard to identify in recycling, or I was also looking at textiles that had elasticity in them, which are also in their conventional form a huge issue for recycling machines, I was creating textiles that would replicate some of those characteristics, whether a coating effect or some form of elasticity. But because of the techniques that I was using and the ways in which I was diverting my textile knowledge, I was actually achieving like quite radical designs that didn't directly respond to the initial conventional textile, but went somewhat further. And I really like this idea, which is by Viktor Papinek in The Green Imperative, where he actually, way back in 1983, talks about how when designers will really sort of like start understanding and taking sustainability criteria into account in their design brief, we might be able to move away from what he defines as conventional design for his time, which is very egocentric and follows the designer's intention first and foremost without taking into account the whole systems that go around it. And he suggests that taking sustainability into account in the design process might actually really help us to go beyond conventional aesthetics and create more interesting designs. So I took all these techniques into a jacket prototype. So the idea here was really to respond to a specific product which had recyclability issues. So a lot of jackets are made of a lining and an outer layer, which are made of two different materials and are constructed in quite complex ways, which make it quite hard to recover the whole, like all of the materials. So using my design for disassembly techniques, I assembled a biodegradable leather with a recycled polyester lining so that the garment could be completely deconstructed or even repaired in some instances, and the resources could be recovered in a circular economy framework. And that's where I stopped my PhD research, and that's like how I round up the conclusions that I wrote in the thesis. But while I was doing all this work, I actually got quite interested in moving beyond the placeholder materials that I'd been using, because as much as those gave me a full range of different techniques, there was really something missing in that dialogue between the designer and the material, trying to understand how the characteristics of a felt, of a leather, might actually guide the design process. So I started off with a few experiments. These were actually done when I was trying to move from the placeholder material samples to the jacket to try and see how the leather would react to the techniques that I'd developed and tweaking the laser settings. And I got a bit carried away and I started experimenting with sandwich materials using a wool sort of interlayer, trying to think about how that might be an interesting criteria, sort of an interesting characteristic that could be used for insulation if you were thinking about a jacket. I had to backtrack on that at that point because of having to write the thesis. But these are things that I feel would be extremely exciting to take up with the focus on fibres that is going to be the focus of the Boisbuchet residency. And actually sort of going back to that understanding of materials and seeing how understanding the criteria and sort of the history and the place of a material in nature can become a huge part of how it becomes this temporary narrative in a way as a combination with something else. And I think that's one of the beauties that comes with designing materials, is that you get to combine different resources which have their own history and they come together and something new happens. So this is one of the frustrations that came from the having to limit the PhD that I really hope to explore in the residency. And this is just like one last example of how I've been starting to experiment with radically opposed resources here, using a biocellulose, so kombucha leather, that's been laser cut and added as a form of, sequin on a polyester base. And this is just starting pulling threads of thoughts around how we can think of material temporalities and imagine how a very, very short-lived, completely biodegradable, low-impact material can come and complement a polyester, which is a completely different story in terms of its durability, of like the way that it moves through the textile system. And on the right here, this is it's a sandwich material with a polyester on the top and then wool in the middle, and then the kombucha is the dark layer that you can just see coming from underneath it there. So this is really about trying to understand how these different of material temporalities can come together in one material for a transient time that doesn't have any impact on the future recyclability of those resources. And yeah, really excited to learn more about hemp and sisal and to take that on as a group activity as part of the residency.
Thank you, Laetitia. Thank you so much. Very fascinating to learn more about your research and practice within the constraints or challenges or opportunity given by a sustainable angle. We're approaching 2 o'clock, so I would open up to our participants to see if there's any questions from anyone. You're welcome to put your question in the chat box or just raise your hand if you want to ask your questions in person. For now, we have a really nice comment. Wonderful presentations. Thank you. Any question, anyone? Well, I can start with a question to Mathias, because you gave a very brief overview of the Domaine de Boisbuchet. I was wondering what was the mission and the vision at the core of the project, and how much through the years, through these amazing collaborations and networks that you have established, how much that vision has shaped your program, or the collaboration influenced also your direction?
To offer that opportunity to young people getting out of the academic frame and test ideas in that experimental platform, or on that experimental workshops, alongside very experienced and innovative experts from all over the world in a very international and interdisciplinary way. That was the initial idea, which expanded very much into in terms of disciplines, but also in terms of corporations. As I mentioned in my lecture, we are working with museums, with companies, with universities, with NGOs, and we consider now Boisbuchet really as an open air laboratory, which functions as a that connects expertise of various fields from the world with the expertise and the advantages which are here very local, which is not only Boisbuchet with its nature and the architecture, the library, and the, but it's also farmers around us. It's the hospital which is close by. It is the community in the next village. So, or the refugees. Or the schools. So we are seeing ourselves as an institution which allows people from all over the world to practice something on a real scale. In the university, everything remains on an abstract level, or on a how do you call that in English? Reagenzglas. It's these in vitro, but here in large scale, and it feels also very real. And this whole and something which proves extremely advantageous is the social dimension in this, because the participants are they are sharing rooms, first of all share rooms, most of them, and from breakfast until the late evening around a campfire or so, or a presentation or a lecture, something, or a party, a costume party, which is also one of our weekly customs, everything is shared, and the whole becomes something which is not only technically and regard to the discipline you are interested in, but it also becomes something very, very personal.
Yeah, in a way, we were chatting before the talk. There's this sense of merging, of blending, to go back to Laetitia, of work and life in such a unique setting, which I guess it's a unique experience for your artists and designers and for you and all the staff as well. We have a few questions from the chat. One question from Alondra to Lisa, who is saying, Lisa, do you see your work involving science again in the future? And if yes, could you expand in which way?
And also to add to that, If you could share a little bit about the art and science course and how that developed with your practice.
Okay, quite a big thing to cover, but I'll try and do it in 30 seconds. So the Central St. Martin's art and science degree has been going, I think, for about 7 or 8 years. It's managing to survive this sort of dispersed learning because of COVID, but I think they're still doing fabulous things. The important thing about that course is that you get people that are artists coming to learn about science or investigate science, and you've got scientists who perhaps have a first degree in a science, biology or psychology, coming to the course, learning more about their creativity and how they want to see the world from a creative point of view. So the cross-pollination is actually an integral part of the course itself, and everybody supports each other in doing either bits of research, but it's also very motivating when you see how other people are progressing through their research, making contacts with the right people, putting together research projects, etc. And there's a lot of outside projects which are brought to the group to get involved in if you're interested, etc. So I'd very much recommend the course. I think because of that, and the reason why I went to the course was to align my practice more with science. And of course, this residency that I did at the Space Lab was a fantastic way to go straight into applying that knowledge and that desire to enrich my practice and steer my practice through the lens of science, so to speak, into exploring a way to express things that are quite difficult to talk about in a way, because natural forces like gravity are around you every day and we don't really think about them. And I like my work to reflect partially the physical experience of looking at natural forces, but also it's important for me to understand how these things have developed in our world and in the universe. And I find that really fascinating, and all of that feeds back into my practice. I'm currently researching a project which involves spiral galaxies, the actual shape of spiral galaxies, and how scientists see the shapes of galaxies evolving and the information that's coming from that. And also the shape of the spiral itself. I'm often really interested in the aesthetics of where things take root in our imaginations. That, for instance, the spiral shape in some recent research that I've done is present in many Neolithic, on Neolithic stones in sites such as in Ireland. And I've just been unpicking why they're using those particular shapes, and indeed they actually relate back to astronomical occurrences that have been happening there for thousands and thousands of years. So we live with these particular shapes, and yet, and also we're seeing them happen out in the universe, and I'm working towards finding some connection between the two, and also joining these two different ideas of aesthetics and actually science together through a particular theme of galaxy shapes. So we'll see how that progresses.
From Francesco, who is asking, is Domaine de Boisbuchet planning to change its workshop program to adapt to the COVID-19 pandemic, besides postponing in-person residency?
I read that message, the question. We are trying to keep the program as it is published right now as long as possible, which until it happens. If the restrictions of the French or the international government prevent workshops, we will have to cancel them and postpone them. We won't translate them or transform them into something online to keep the program as complete as possible. But at the same time, we are still working on in residence program, which we are going to offer in spring and in autumn, and in the worst case we will continue that in the summer. Seriously, we are also developing an online workshop program, which I don't know yet which exact format that, but it's something we are developing not only in regard to the COVID situation, but as a general, in general, as an additional service Boisbuchet offers to the community. So that is something we will develop in the next couple of months. Hopefully that will be then available maybe in June or July. I can't really promise anything right now. It depends on many circumstances. The situation is difficult for all of us, but again, we try to keep that up as possible, as good as possible.
Thank you. There are certainly some advantages of moving certain aspects of the program online in terms of reaching wider audiences or participants. And in the case of our conversations, for instance, you're based in France, it wouldn't be difficult to have you here to talk to our students. So there are some good aspects attached to the use of digital within the restrictions now.
Maybe I can add one aspect which is important. One of the advantages, we talked quickly about it before the session here, one of the advantages of Boisbuchet is, of course, the open air environment and the spacious facilities.
Just to say that Laetitia unfortunately has to leave us. She has a meeting. So I just want to thank Laetitia very much for the presentation. It was very, very, very interesting. I really wish you can go to Boisbuchet this summer and develop further your project. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot for the opportunity to get a taster, and it was really great to meet you, Lisa, and Mathias. Thanks.
Thanks. Bye. Mathias, sorry. See you again.
Looking forward to meeting you. Bye.
Mathias, would you like to continue?
Well, I practically said everything already. It's just that we had also last year university classes from Paris, or we had a group from Spain here, that interdisciplinary group. The facilities are really ideal to run workshops, even in a group of 20 people. We have the space, we have the open air around, we have plenty of accommodation. Our kitchen is really equipped professionally and according to all the sanitary rules. The dining areas and outdoor, all the different laboratories and seminar rooms and spaces, indoors and outdoors, to realize are equipped in a way that even larger groups can live and work together under these difficult circumstances.
Thank you. I think we need to end here. It's 2:02. People are leaving already. So I just wanted to thank again Mattia, Schwartz-Clauss, and Lisa Pettibone for joining us today and sharing with us your ideas, thoughts, and practice. Laetitia, again, we already said bye to her. Thank you, Abby. Abby shared the links and contacts, so if any of you has further questions, they can get in contact directly with our guest. And I hope to see you all next Wednesday for our next appointment at 1:00. Thank you so much, and I'll see you next week.